freedom.
KFYR.
Todd Mitchell.
Todd Mitchell.
A pre-planned show? Are you kidding? Why would we start that now? We've never done that in years. KFYR Cafe doors have swung open. Game and Fish coming in after four. I'm thinking Don't Go on the Ice is going to be in there someplace because, yeah, maybe it got to 11 below or whatever. But it's going to get in the 40s this weekend, and the last thing you want to do is fall in the water. Jesse knows what it's like to have fallen in the water. As well,
I have
as
fallen in the water. Not through the ice, but I've fallen into water before.
Well,
so I know the feeling of it, just not through the ice. So yeah, you're wise in saying that. Yeah, don't go on the ice.
The last person who could reliably walk on top of the water did that 2020 years ago, give or take.
That's a correct.
And it was tough giving him baths back then too, because he always stood on top of the water.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Get in there.
But you're wrong in saying we don't want that in terms of somebody falling through the ice. We do want it in terms of, you know, a nice little warm up here.
Well, yeah, we don't mind a warm up.
Absolutely nice.
It better be gradual enough that we don't need a bunch of flooding.
Right. That's why. That's why 30s
like
and 40s here.
Right.
Good stretches.
We got farmers who are meeting about, gee, what are we going to plant in 2020? And they're all looking at each other, going, "Do you have 2019 on the ground yet?" No. I remember mining in February. I so bad want to do the whole Thunberg joke with that. And Mike Bloomberg taught me everything I need to know about farming.
I hope not. Oh my goodness.
It's his own words. I don't have to. That's the beauty of it. All I have to do is quote him. I don't have to pick on him. He said it.
And you'll get more material of it tonight.
I know. And two things you don't find at the Democratic debate: the American flag and commercial radio coverage. They don't want it. They will not let it be covered. Rob Port's on the edge of his seat waiting for tonight, too, right? That's your big assignment tonight?
Yeah. Well, apparently farming's super easy, according to Mike Bloomberg. Like,
that's just what I heard.
Any stupid idiot could do it, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, all you have to do is dig a hole, you put the seed in, and then you wait. Maybe water it a little bit.
Yeah.
Make sure you get some sun.
I can't adequately care for a cactus, so I'm not going to give it farmers... I'm not going to give farmers any grief because I'm a complete idiot when it comes to that stuff. And it is complicated. You ever hear them talk? It is a flippant science. They're talking about soil temperatures. They're talking about, you know, the pH balance of the soil, everything else. It's a lot that goes into it, Mike Bloomberg. There should be a reality show. It's like, remember when they put those two idiot heiresses out, right? And they were out on the farm or something. Remember years ago?
Oh, my God. I haven't thought of that one in years.
What was that? That should be a new TV show. Let's make Mike Bloomberg go farm. Like, here's the implements, Mike, you brilliant man, eighth richest man in the United States or whatever the hell he is. Go make something come out of the ground that's useful. Go do that. And then
I've got it. You ready for this one? We're going to start Thunberg a Go Farm Me account.
Go farm me?
To get him all the money he needs. For seeds and everything else to start that farm.
Here's the seeds. Here's the shovel and everything. Survive off the land for a year. Now I
wonder
now, I
if
say
he
that,
could
I say
even
that,
farm a Farmville farm.
Okay, I say
you
that,
remember those, right?
I say that again. I couldn't garden myself, but I'm also not the one out there calling farmers idiots. So, you know.
Right. See, that's just it. It's his own words. I mean, we can all sit there and put labels on the various people out there and say, well, I bet they'd say stuff like, or to me, every time they talk, they sound like, this is direct quoting here. We don't have to characterize what he's saying. We don't even have to, you know, I mean, a lot of times people say, well, you're mischaracterizing this. There's no characterization here. It's his own words.
Yeah.
It's just what he said. my good friend Tim reminds me of the movie Son-in-Law. You remember that movie, right?
Well, that was Pauly
Shore.
Pauly Shore, that's right.
Yeah.
Who played the dad in that? Who played the father-in-law?
Yeah, I can picture him. I can't think of his name.
He just died recently, too, didn't he?
Our crack research team is looking it up right now on his phone. That would be Jesse Rosfit here.
I'm all over it.
Rob Port, sayanythingblog.com, a forum columnist. What else do I need to make sure to say about you?
I don't know. Podcast.
Is that enough?
Jerk. I don't know. Whatever you want.
See, now, I like to let people make up their own minds on that, and I don't think of that as you.
Lane Smith,
especially after your Friday column.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Because... Well. I got to admit, there are plenty of us out here in the West that thought you guys in the East didn't necessarily quite grasp the depth of Dapple here.
Well, first of all, I want to point out, I live in Minot. I think people forget that sometimes because
Forum's a Fargo thing, and we know you've got some of their genes in your head now. That's all right. You're doing your best to.
You know, we have papers like Dickinson, Jamestown, all over the place. Anyway, no, I'm from Minot.
I know.
I covered the Dakota Access Pipeline extensively.
You did spend some time on WDAY, and last I knew that was still. This is supposed to be WDAY week. We just had Jay Thomas on. Who else should I have?
Although I broadcasted from Minot, so that was.
Should I have Capel on tomorrow, or what should I do here?
Yeah, no, go ahead.
Get the whole lineup on. Who else am I missing?
I think that's great.
I am not putting McFeely on. Forget that one.
Aren't you?
We had him on for years on here, and it worked out disastrously. So.
But anyway.
All right. Did you find? And of course, the grandfather was Bartles or James. Remember that scene?
Yeah.
Which one are you, dude? Bartles or James?
I feel like the brilliance of that movie was
based in South Dakota, and really, you know, if you put a California kid in a South Dakota ranch or farm or North Dakota, it probably wouldn't have turned out that different. Your California character would probably end up with chaps or shaps and cheek chillers as they were.
I have watched some documentaries. There's some pretty good farmers in Humboldt County, California, I've heard. Pretty good at farming, at the agricultural botanicals up there.
Well, there are good farmers in California, but as you go to the campus...
I'm talking about the mural. I'm trying to make a joke.
I know. But, I mean, there are some actual farmers in California, but they weren't on that. Was it UCLA or USC, or what was the campus, or was it like a fictitious school?
I have no idea.
Widget High College or something.
I don't know where it was.
But that was the thing, though, is, you know, she was city college to see what the SoCal life was like, blah, blah, blah. And then you bring the boy back to the son-in-law is a must. Okay. That's one of those.
We're losing the younger audience here. They're like, what is this?
What younger audience, dude? This is the mature yet full of life audience of KFYR 550 here. The younger audience is next door on Y93, and I was on that for 16 years, and I'm far too old to be on that stuff right now. And actually, Jesse Rosfit's still here, and he hasn't left the room, so he must still.
You're not losing me as an audience, but I've in terms of talking about the movie, I've been lost the whole time.
Son-in-law came out 27 years ago.
Oh, shut up! Are you serious?
Serious?
Oh my God! Where's my walker?
Oh my God!
I am old. Really? So Pauly Shore must have gray hair by now.
I wonder what he looks like today.
See, now 27 plus 27, so he's got to be in his 50s by now.
Oh, he does not look good.
He doesn't. I'm not sure I want to see it. That's going to totally tarnish the image.
He's 52.
52, okay. I wasn't too far off. I was 54.
52 is not that old, says the guy who's turning 40 this year. But
you're turning 40?
Yeah, I'm so old.
Oh my gosh.
Remember when I was
Are you still watching Sesame Street every day then? Because you're so young.
Are you talking about
I'm old enough to be your father.
Do you know how long I've been running the bus? Because I know you and I have done stuff, a lot of stuff over the years, worked together a little bit here and there. I've been doing sayanythingblog.com for 16 years, going on 17 now this fall.
He was doing Say Anything Blog when you had AOL dial-up.
I literally started the blog on a dial-up internet connection. It's older than YouTube.
It was not
it's
too
older
far
than
off.
Facebook. It's almost older than MySpace.
Oh, wow. And I still maintain the whole reason Facebook took off was MySpace screwed up their own platform. Anybody who remembers MySpace back in its day, you could change your page, you could have music pop up, you could have all the designs in the world you wanted pop up. And next thing you know, you couldn't read anybody's page. Then along came Facebook, and you could read what was there.
Yeah.
and you weren't blasted away by somebody's incredibly loud music. And I still think MySpace is the reason Facebook succeeded. It chased everybody over to Facebook.
You think so?
Oh, absolutely. Hands down.
Could be.
But I remember CompuServe and Prodigy. If you want to go back further than that, then we're talking Pong.
Well, even before, because we had a, I remember having a Prodigy account, and it was a walled garden. Like, the World Wide Web didn't exist. Matter of fact, I remember the first time I got on what we know of today as the web was through Prodigy, and it was like a special thing you had to go to, like the off-ramp Prodigy service.
Yep.
And go on the World Wide Web. Yeah, it was.
Yep, I remember that. AOL had a similar thing back in the day. CompuServe.
I don't know why.
There was nothing there.
I don't know why.
The spider that designed the World Wide Web was laying its first egg yet.
I don't know why we're going down memory lane here, but in high school, like the schools immediately tried to jump on like the internet bandwagon, and so they had like a web design class when I was in high school, and I went to it, and they had the driver's ed teacher teaching it, who had. Not a clue. But as you might imagine, I was very interested in websites early on. I mean, I started a website and became kind of an important place for North Dakota politics. And if you go back in the archives, though, of the Minot Daily News, I think like 1995, Keith Darnay, who's been kind of a columnist guy in our region for a long time, he actually wrote a column about Rob's Polaris website. It was a website I made about Polaris snowmobiles when I was 14 years old. And it was,
and it's still there.
It's gone now. Thank God. I'm glad that chapter of.
I think there's somewhere because you know KFYR had sites long before I came to work at KFYR, and that was in '97. Yeah. I'm not sure how far back before that. At least '95, probably further.
Anyway,
and somewhere we've still got some of the graphics, and it is kind of fun to go back and watch that. The first modem. This sounds like a joke, because those who remember rotary phones remember rotary phones. The first computer modem I ever worked with used a rotary phone. You called on the rotary office, you know, Ma Bell phone.
And then you had to set, like, the receiver down on it? Is that what
Yep, you put the receiver in the suction cup-looking things there.
I remember those.
And then...
Yeah.
So... I'm so old, my first modem was a rotary phone, is a true story.
I remember.
And I don't want to think about how big a bell I ran up at our school,
I was lucky. We were so far off the rails on the segment, but I was lucky that my dad was a gadget head, bought me an IBM Franklin 8086 with a 10 megabyte external hard drive that I played Master Ninja on with 5.25 inch floppy disks. In the day in my basement in Wasilla, Alaska, next to our wood-burning stove. I'm guessing
I still have a few of those discs.
Do you?
Around someplace.
Apparently, the federal government still runs the nuclear missiles off those discs, still to this day.
What?
Yeah, because they're reliable. In fact, they have to get them specially made now, because they're not commercially available anymore. But yeah, the computers that run the nukes, apparently... Because we were just...
Well, it's not like the code technology's changed.
Well, that's their argument.
One, two, three, four. That sounds like a code that idiot would have in his luggage.
Well,
different movie.
The argument is, I guess they're so old they can't hack it. Like, it's so old, it's not...
Good point.
Yeah.
That's a good point, because you know what? The software we used to have for broadcast before this next-gen stuff we have now ran on Windows 3.1, and that was one of the things that they... kind of dragged their feet on getting into Windows at the time, 98 or whatever, was that it was more hackable, or XP or whatever was more hackable, whereas 3.1 nobody was bothering. There's no purpose in hacking 3.1. There's nothing there.
And now everybody's hacked. Credit Karma just sent me an email the other day that my personal information had been included in like 91 data breaches, and I'm like, well, super. I mean, is there even a point at this point? I mean, everybody's just got everything now. I guess I'll just start posting.
I've always maintained that if you can get rich off my name, you go ahead. I haven't figured out how to pull that off yet. Yeah. But if you can pull it off. By the way, Walter Warner's was played by Lane Smith.
Yeah, that's right.
And I could not think of As far as I know, he died in 2005.
Yeah, well, so that long ago? Jeez, Louise.
I know, right? Don't you feel old?
I am so old.
15 years ago?
15 years ago. The movie came out 27 years ago.
Oh, man. So that means Walter died 12 years after the movie was made. How sad.
Yeah.
He seemed so young, man. So, you have to let the dog out?
Who let the dog out? My daughter came home and now the dog is barking at her.
Yeah, some of us get to work from home. I'm not one of them, and that's another reason I'm not ever going to be able to work from home. I think it's probably one of the reasons iHeart will never let me work from home. My dogs will never shut up.
Yeah.
We'll be barking in the background the whole time. You do realize Who Let the Dogs Out was not a song about dogs.
Yeah.
Yes. I didn't know that.
What's the deeper meaning behind Who Let the Dogs Out?
You didn't know?
I have no idea. What is...
Girls in Bars.
Oh, is it?
The less attractive girls.
Well, that is a really
the
mean
ones
song
that you end
now.
Up waking up at 10 and you find out there are two and you go home at 2 of the 10.
My kids are listening to that song on Kids Bop or whatever. That's
what
they
it's probably about. Don't know that part, or maybe they do. I don't know.
Well, I think you might be one of the only people that knew that. I think I learned it from you originally.
Really?
That's terrible.
Well, I feel like you posted about it.
I probably did. I don't
at
know.
Some
do,
point.
Do you actually know this? Is this something you just made up, Todd?
No,
is this fake news?
No, what? No, news. They were on
Facebook fake news. That's what this is.
What were they? They were on one of the late TV shows talking about it. And it's like, well, it'd crush my world. Because now every time I have like the Humane Society or whatever, by the way, Central Dakota Humane Society is coming up on a show real soon here, by the way. We've got to figure that one out. I can't use that now. I got to go back to Atomic Dog, I guess, George Clinton. No. Which is also not about dogs, but
yeah,
still.
I don't know that song either.
What?
I don't know.
Hold on. I mean, you think I don't have that right at my fingertips? George Clinton, Parliament, Funkadelic. The movie PCU is a must-see.
That's the only
You remember
place
that
I
movie?
I remember that movie with Jeremy Piven.
It seems
Piven.
Like nobody knows that movie but me,
Jeremy
and
Piven.
Now there's you. Thank God.
With Jeremy Piven, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Early Jeremy Piven.
Very funny movie.
And George Clinton can't find his way to the gig, and he plays the frat house without ruining the movie for anybody.
What's his name? Director, did Swingers. God, what's his name? Worked with Vince Vaughn all the time. Plays Happy in the Avengers movies. He's a director, too.
I got it right on the tip of my tongue.
I'm just
John Favreau's in that, isn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah, yep. John Favreau's in PC.
There you go. That's one of those like sleeper movies that people don't know, and when you see it, it's like, oh, that was fun.
This is a pretty good movie, actually.
It was a good movie. So anyway, see, now you're getting the hang of this show, in case you ever fill in for me.
Hey, I go on with Jay Thomas every Monday, and we are always completely off the rails.
That's because by this time of the day, I can't think of anything Scott Hennon or Rush Limbaugh or who's ever filling in for Rush Limbaugh haven't already said to make the world a better place, other than maybe hitting the farming thing one more time, that Thunberg does not have the answers. And there are so many sound bites. Is it going to bite him in the butt tonight? What do you think?
You know what's amazing to me is I was just looking at all the delegate count leaders for the party, and it's Bernie Sanders, or the poll. It's Bernie Sanders, Michael Bloomberg, and Joe Biden at the top. You have three white men, almost in their 80s, are leading the top of the most diverse party
and why is the world nothing but a bunch of old white men, and then in their own party,
that's what it is evolved or devolved
they
or whatever.
They had two
into.
White men billionaires in their republic in the Democratic field. Anyway, we could go down that rabbit hole if you want, but my goodness,
I go down every rabbit hole I see. That's part of my problem. I got 55 years of running down rabbit holes in my entire life. That's all I know to do anymore. But why is Amy Klobuchar up there talking to Spanish people, Hispanic people? Like, I took Spanish in fourth grade, and I couldn't roll my R's and all that stuff. You heard about that, right?
No, what was she doing?
Something about she had tried to speak Spanish, but she couldn't say her name in Spanish. She had to take a different name because she couldn't roll her R's. What? Where's the R in Amy again?
Klobuchar.
I get. Well, but even. Well, I guess. Okay. So
are you
don't
supposed
roll
to roll
the,
that R? Are you supposed to you roll that,
roll that
even
R
if you're
at
Spanish,
the end of Klobuchar?
Okay.
Yeah, maybe that was what she was getting into.
I don't
into,
know. I slept through high school Spanish.
That's so I'm trying to think which one is being the most self-destructive. Back to President Pocahontas, or I was trying to be a Spanish student and all that in fourth grade? Who takes it in fourth grade? Yeah. It's seventh,
every,
but whatever.
Every politician does that, though, where they try to have some phony baloney. Like, they'll show up at the sports game and like, yeah, I'm a real baseball fan. Remember when Barack Obama was throwing out first pitches? Like, somebody gave him his mom's pants and he went out there and he was trying to throw the ball. And remember, like, it was right around the time, at the same time, they had that commercial where it's like, you throw like a girl, and it was about women in sports and, like, how women are actually really good at sports, which is true, which I agree with, but they had that whole thing, like, you throw like a girl, and then Barack Obama's out there trying to throw the first pitch, and what does he throw like? A girl.
A girl.
Yeah.
I don't care about stuff like that.
I don't need the president to be a pitcher. I don't really care how good his pitches are. I'd rather him just pass good policy. I don't care. I don't even really need to like these people. I just want them to pass the right policies.
You would think in 2020 people would know better than to try to make up facts about themselves because there's fact checkers all over the planet these days.
Well, especially on the internet, it happens in real time.
Exactly. So why make up something that can so easily be disproven?
I don't know. And
so you have Elizabeth Warren up asking Biden, are you trying to call me a liar?
Yeah.
I don't know. What percentage liar are you?
I mean, you pretended to be a Native American
you?
Woman for,
Yeah.
There was a great Onion headline. I think it was from last year, but there's a great Onion headline. It was like, Elizabeth Warren upset, takes DNA test, finds she's only 0.0012% presidential material.
That sounds like the Onion. That's why the Onion rocks. But could you imagine if a Republican candidate or anybody by the last name or any remotely resemblance of Trump were to make such a claim, because Elizabeth Warren's claim, proven false, sort of just evaporated.
Well, the thing that bugs me about that is I was like, well, it didn't help her. She didn't actually use it. Well, then why did she claim it? Like, you're in the academic
field. Yeah, really.
Why would you claim to be partially Native American? And at one point, Harvard sent her out and, like, listed her among their minority faculty, which, by the way, had to surprise the hell out of some people opening up that directory. And all of a sudden, there's white bread Elizabeth Warren staring back at you like she's Native American. Like, oh, all right.
I mean, I suppose if you're told your whole life that, yeah, your ancestor was blah, 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 well, okay. But if she really thought she'd play that card as some advantage getter, why do that?
I don't know.
Why lie about something like that?
Well, especially
because,
like,
it could be so easily disproven,
well,
and you look like an idiot.
Like,
not to mention a racist.
Well, the thing is,
once it's done,
you're already super qualified. Like whatever you want to think about Elizabeth Warren's policies, and I think they suck. She's a smart lady. She taught it at Harvard. She's a published author. She's a successful person.
Everything she tries to do to improve upon that buries her deeper.
Why do you need to make anything else up? Just campaign on that.
You'd think. Well, that's. Maybe she's got some terrible handlers around here. I'm dying to let's get her on the Steve Wilkos show or something about have her do a series of questions on a lie detector.
What I don't understand is like
where it was that she started down that rabbit hole of being part American Indian when she's clearly not.
Where did that start? Well, even where she kept doubling down on it. Like if right away if she just said, you know what, that was a mistake. It was a family myth. Clearly I'm not Native American. You know, I don't have that heritage. So, you know, and she could have just put it in the past, right? And at this point, it might be a little bit of a joke. But no, she kicked off when she was kicking off her presidential campaign last year, she comes out with like the DNA test. And was like she was vindicated, like, ha ha, I'm like 1/1000th Native American, you know, I'm right and all you guys are wrong. And everybody laughed at her.
What would have happened if Rob Port had done that?
Well, I don't even want to know.
Texter wants to know, here's a good question. How come Lori Loughlin went to prison for falsifying college resumes, but Elizabeth Warren does not? How does that work?
Well, Lori Loughlin, I don't know. That's a good point. I mean, fraud is fraud.
If you're lying about to get your kids in some advantage, it's okay. And I get, certainly if a parent is doing something that the kid is not complicit, then it's kind of hard to punish the kid if you know, whack job, loose cannon mom decides, I'm going to do all this weird stuff for my daughter, and the daughter didn't know that was going on, or knew but wasn't, you know,
Did you hear the Ricky Gervais joke where at the Oscars, the Golden Globes, whatever it was. I can't remember all these shows. I don't watch them.
I don't watch
them. But he had the one, and it was, he said he came here, his license plate had been made by Lori Loughlin in jail.
Oh man! And he got out of there on his own power.
Maybe it was. You have to watch that monologue he did at the Golden Globes.
I am gonna have to watch that.
He told that they all had to fly their own planes there instead of flying on Jeffrey Epstein's plane, and they were all groaning. And he's like, "Shut up! He's your friend."
Oh, stellar!
It was fantastic.
Finally, they get a smart move. You know how our numbers are record low, but I know exactly how we can get them up. If we put those kind of jokes in there, then the Republicans and the conservatives are going to come back and watch.
Well, hey, that's the key to Fox News' success. It was the key to Rush Limbaugh's success. Everybody went to them because there was nowhere else for conservatives to go. We're such an underserved.
True.
Really, conservative points of it, it's a lot better now than it used to be with the internet and everything else. People today are spoiled. But I remember being a kid in the backseat. If you wanted a conservative point of view, it was like you could subscribe to one like National Review or something. Or, you know, but it like on drive time home, if you wanted a conservative point of view, Rush Limbaugh was it. That was it.
Hey,
in terms of just a national.
I remember when Rush Limbaugh first came on, and he was really more of a rock and roller.
Right.
I mean, because he is an old top 40 guy. Conservatism back then.
Kind of a shock jock type guy, right?
Right. I mean, conservatism back then was George Will, and you had the button-down shirt and suit and tie, or you're choking the oxygen out of your head. And then along came Rush Limbaugh remember the collar abortions? He used to do, one day a guy called and said, Rush, you're not doing the collar abortion, it's Snurdly, because Snurdly hits the button, and Rush admits, oh my God, you're right, I'm not the one doing the actual collar abortion. I mean, and that's not the kind of thing a conservative would do, my God, that's shocking. And yet he did, and they said it couldn't be done, and he can do it. And then he went functionally deaf for months, still doing a massive talk radio show. I don't care if you hate the guy. There's a science from which we can learn. How the hell did that all happen? Because that's the stuff suicides are made out of. I don't know about you, Rob, but if I were on 600 radio stations and I went deaf, I don't know how well I'd handle it.
I make a living from typing, so I mean, I have nightmares about like breaking a hand.
Yeah, well, you've never seen me try to type.
Rush Limbaugh, early on in my blogging, he mentioned something I wrote on the air. I remember the day it happened. Yeah, it's happened two or three times now over the time. But the first time it happened, I was sitting at Perkins with somebody having lunch, and his show was on, and all of a sudden my phone started blowing up. And I got so many emails, my site crashed, everything else. Yeah, it was something I wrote, and he mentioned my blog on the air, and it blew
nice.
Up. And that really was the first time I kind of thought, you know, maybe this blogging thing might turn into something for me. I mean, he was a big, you know, obviously with any figure, I don't agree with everything he has to say or whatever, but just in terms of his talent and taking a medium and doing just about everything you could possibly do with that medium, dude is amazing.
And against what every expert said could happen. They said it couldn't be done. And he did it in spades.
And then kept doing it. Like, I remember every time it was like, talk radio is dead. And then like, oh, no, Rush Limbaugh still got 25 million listeners.
Yeah. Bill Clinton got elected president. Well, that's the end of Rush. Are you kidding? It's the reinvention.
That was the beginning.
Exactly. Because the outlet was going to be needed. It still is going to be needed. Bill Clinton, the end of Rush? Are you kidding? Where's everybody going to go to complain about what he's doing wrong? Rush. My God. 343 at KFYR, Todd Mitchell. Jesse Rosman in here yet? Jesse's going to try to work all 24 hours of the day. He'll still be here when Phil Parker gets here in the morning. And Rob Port, sayanythingblog.com.
We were on. We were supposed to talk about Greta Thunberg, I think.
We're going to. I'm not done with you yet.
All right.
Do you have to go? Or?
Oh, no. I'm good.
Okay, good. Okay, good. Because you're not done yet. Oh. But I do have to put some of these things in here. Jesse doesn't get a paycheck at the end of the day. He always hates that if I don't play all the commercials, they take it out of Jesse's paycheck.
It hurts.
And then he comes to me and, where's the other half of my check? Oh, well, I was on with Rob Port and decided, let's not worry about any of that today. it's only going to affect Jesse and maybe a few people in New York City. So when we come back, 344, if you saw the Say Anything blog column from, it was Friday, right?
It was last week. I think it was.
He doesn't read his own columns. I don't know. I'll go
look at it. I'm like, that's an interesting topic. I should Google search that. So I'm Googling along, found something I wrote about it 5 years ago. And I'm like, oh, yeah, that's right.
He's written so much stuff, he can Google himself and not recognize his own writing until he gets deep
in. Recognize it when I see it. I just remember, I remember something about that. Like, oh, yeah, I wrote about it.
So is it plagiarizing if you steal your own words?
I don't think it is. I looked it up.
Always remember, stealing from one resource is plagiarism. Stealing from two or more resources is research.
It's Wikipedia.
It's no, making up a source is, yeah, Wikipedia. Oh, sometimes, now, if you're trusting Wikipedia to be, I'm not saying it's all BS on there, but
Wikipedia is a good place to start. I would not use it as your final source, but a lot of times, click on those little footnotes, click on the original source and go read that. That's Wikipedia is a good aggregation place for information. I'll never forget somebody,
and I'm pretty sure it was on Rush, where somebody who was an assistant to some scientist had called, and they were picking apart Wikipedia because she would change the Wikipedia page to reflect accurately. I mean, she was his assistant. I forget who it was. I wish I could remember that. And then somebody would go change it and then contact her and say, look, you're spreading misinformation. I'm like, I'm his assistant. I'm pretty darn close to the source here. I know this. Nope, not right. So, because anybody can write anything about Wikipedia.
I saw somebody, I was watching a debate about vaccinations on Twitter the other day.
Oh,
and somebody told this guy, like some anti-vax guy told the other guy, he's like, why don't you look up the latest science on injections and disease spreading or whatever. So I clicked over to the dude's bio. He's a professor of epidemiology at Harvard. I feel like he's up to date maybe on the latest information about disease outbreaks, but I don't know.
You'd like to think that.
Yeah.
But you never know.
Social media.
I could put that on the Rob Port Wikipedia page, though.
Professor of epidemiology at
Port University in Minot, North Dakota.
I think I have a Wikipedia page that somebody set up. And usually it's just a bunch of insults at me on there. Like,
yeah, I was going to say, if somebody set one up for you, it probably wasn't you. And if it wasn't you, then it's probably not terribly complimentary, right?
No, it was a bunch of, like what a stupid idiot. And
I was a Purdue basketball player. That's the closest to a Todd Mitchell page you're going to find is the old basketball player at Purdue, which was not me, by the way. Never been me. Not even a game of horse in the backyard back in the day. 347, Rob Portmore coming up at the KFYR Cafe.
If you're thinking about it, he's talking.
Ice Cube, who's also doing like Disney stuff now, even though he's a former thugger, as we take the off-air conversation on the air in the KFYR Cafe.
Yeah, I was the other day, I was watching like my kids, like watching some TV, kids programming, and Snoop Dogg's on there. Snoop Dogg. Like when I was
grab
a kid,
one of the early Ice-T videos. I mean, here he's done Law and Order or whichever one it is, where he's been a cop all this time. His early videos, he was a cop killer.
Snoop Dogg was accused of murdering a guy.
Yeah.
And now he's on my kid's Fire tablet, like
only
with
one
building
guy?
Blocks and stuff. Yeah, I don't know.
he's probably been accused of... only formally charged with killing one guy.
I am all for, like, a lot of this criminal justice reform and forgiveness and all that. I'm a libertarian. I'm all for that. But I draw the line at Snoop Dogg singing the alphabet with my kid. I just, you know, my kids can get introduced to Snoop when they're a little earlier.
Okay, look. I'd rather trust my kid in a night at Snoop's house than Michael Jackson's house.
Okay.
What does that
mean?
Well,
okay, yeah. I mean, would you like a punch in the face or a punch in the stomach? I mean, I don't know.
354
KFYR. How about neither? That's a choice.
How about neither? How about a nice Greta Thunberg mural in Fargo? Are you going to go and check it out?
Yeah, why not? I never saw what the big deal was. I mean, obviously, anybody who is familiar with my work knows how I feel about Greta Thunberg. I think that her activism is an inch deep and a mile wide. I think that her age is a shield for criticism, because if you criticize her, it's, oh, look at all these men who are critical of Greta Thunberg, all these old men. Although, by the way, there's plenty of women and plenty of young people who are critical of Greta Thunberg, too. It's kind of an idiotic thing that she's pushing for. She wants an immediate divestment in the production of the fuel on which the world runs. Right? Nobody's flying back and forth across the Atlantic if we're not pumping oil out of the ground. So I'm sorry, exactly. Greta. That's an insane thing to call for. And if you were a little bit older, I feel like less people would be paying attention to you, because it's a very stupid thing that you want. All that being said, if an artist wants to put her likeness up on the side of a building, and it's a private building, and they want to do it with private funds and all that, I don't know whose business that is, if anybody else.
I don't have a problem with anybody doing it, but if you're going to be doing something that polarizing, be it Greta, be it Trump, be it whatever, whoever.
If you're going to bring politics into your business, you're going to get, it's going to be controversial. It's going to be polarizing.
Right. Or heck, it can be how great the New York Yankees are. Well, then you're going to get plenty of people that hate the Yankees that might throw eggs at it, too.
I don't know about that.
Especially if you put it in Boston. But
maybe a Boston. The poor benighted people of Boston wouldn't know what to do with a baseball team that good. But
Shane does wonderful work, by the way, too. No indictment of Shane whatsoever. He does extremely good work.
I'm not so
absolutely
sure.
Good.
It's art. It's art. I'm whatever. It's not my taste.
It's something I put in my living room. It's not about whether I can appreciate more than a lot of other art out there.
Sure, fair enough. It's not about whether. Yeah, I like it better than the banana duct taped to the wall.
That looks like the kind of thing I do and call art.
Yeah,
and somebody would go, well, okay, it's Todd. He doesn't know anything about art, but okay,
it's like an onion piece, and it really happened. It's not about whether or not I like it or you like it or anything else. It's art. Somebody wanted to put it up. They should be able to put it up without being threatened and without fear of vandalism and stuff like that. That stuff went over.
But it does conjure an image out here.
It does. And that was the point of my column, now that we're finally getting to it, 45 minutes after I came on the program. The point of my column was that, listen, the Bismarck community still has some scars from when it went on during the pipeline protests. It was terrible. I still remember the interviews I did. A lot of them were off the record with law enforcement officers who were going through that. To this day, a lot of them have PTSD. Look at a lot of the law enforcement leaders, by the way, who led the charge, you know, who were really, you know, organized that. For the state of North Dakota, Sheriff Kirkmeyer out of Morton County, right?
I asked him, I said, would you have run for sheriff if you didn't know this was all coming down? He said, oh, hell no.
Yeah. Look at how many of them aren't in law enforcement anymore.
Sure. There's
a lot of rank and file law who left after that. It was terrible. And it was all the worse because even as this is happening, right, they're lighting trucks on fire and trying to like block the railroad tracks in Mandan. They're you know, the poor ranchers down in that region, the people who are just trying to get back and forth to work and drive through that part of the state, you know, had to go miles out of their way around all these detours, and every day was new protests. I mean, it was the vandalism, the violence. It was terrible. And all the while it was going on, then we have the National Press Corps that came to North Dakota with one narrative in mind, and they wanted it to be Ferguson protests north. They wanted it to be another narrative where these mean law enforcement in this mean, mostly white, racist, conservative state was being mean to the Native American community. And that wasn't it. There were a lot of anti-pipeline protesters, although I disagree with them, who were there in good faith trying to have their say about this pipeline. But you cannot ignore that there was a faction who terrorized the Bismarck region. And so
exactly.
When you want to put up a mural about Greta Thunberg, yeah, that's going to be some salt and some old wounds.
Exactly. And maybe Fargo is the place for it. Maybe it's going to be accepted more there because it wasn't quite so close to the front line.
I don't know if it will be. I hope it is. I hope people don't vandalize it. I hope people don't do stupid things. If you want to be critical.
I know. Egging is so fourth grade. I'm with you. It's like really egging?
Grow up.
Wow.
Yeah. But, I mean, if you want to be critical of it, have at it, because I'm going to be critical of it. But, you know, they're going to put it up, and that's fine. Honestly, I wish it could go up anywhere. We live in the United States of America. Artists shouldn't have to be afraid to display their art, especially
if it's
controversial.
And then I'll go drink at the place across the street from the place that's got it up.
Right, yeah. If you don't want to go to that business anymore because they put up the mural, that's your choice. But just, you know, we live
exactly.
in the United States, and, you know, the First Amendment doesn't exist to protect stuff we like. It exists explicitly to protect things we don't like.
Rob, I gotta have you back.
All right.
We're so not done with this. KFYR Bismarck at 4 o'clock.